Hello, I'm Dr. Ahmed Hussain. Today I'm going to share some tips to do well in Station 5 of MRCP PACES clinical examination. We all know that Station 5 is a very vital station to do well in PACES because among the all stations, it carries the maximum marks, and all the seven skill sets that are being assessed in PACES actually are being assessed in Station 5. So, pass or fail depends how a candidate performs in Station 5. And what are the skill sets that are being assessed in MRCP PACES clinical examination? It is very important to know this skill sets because each candidate have to pass individual skill sets. So number one is clinical communication, number two, physical examination, number three, science, number four, differentials, number five, addressing patient's concern, number six, judgment, and number seven, welfare. So these are the skill sets that are being assessed in PACES, MRCP PACES. And so let's come to the Station 5. So we can divide it into three parts: before entering into the examination room, number two, after entering into the examination room, encounter with the patient, and number three, encounter or crossing with the examiners. Let's discuss one by one. So before entering into the examination room, each candidate will be provided two brief clinical scenario, and he or she will get 5 minutes, and he will also be provided a white paper where he or she can take some notes. Suppose scenario may be like that: Mr. Anderson, 60 years old man, presented with shortness of breath for last 1 month, and they may give some vitals, parameters like blood pressure, pulse or respiratory rate, and also some investigations like complete blood count or urinary or creatinine according to the case scenarios. And what a candidate should do during this important vital 5 minutes. So a candidate should write down the BCC1 and BCC2. BCC means brief clinical consultation 1 and brief clinical consultation 2. And divide the page into two parts and write down BCC1 and BCC2 clearly, and write down the name of the patients and age of the patients clearly, because there are many times many candidates actually mismatch the patients and take false or wrong history from a wrong patient. So it is very vital to write down the name and age of the patients, and then the candidate should write down the symptoms like this patient Anderson. You can write down the Anderson, 60 years and short of breath. And during this period, because it is very small time, and the candidates can write down the some important differentials or some differentials related to the symptoms like shortness of breath. They can divide like respiratory cause of shortness of breath, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease or asthma, interstitial lung disease, pulmonary hypertension, and also some cardiac cause of shortness of breath like angina equivalent, congestive cardiac failure, and other cause of shortness of breath like anemia or obstructive sleep apnea. And write down the differentials of other cases, like if patient presented with head pain, you can write down the differentials of hand pain. So it's very important, vital, and this time is very short. And now after entering to the examination hall, after encounter with the patient is the first part. After entering into the examination room, so encounter the patient, we can divide into it also the three parts, like taking focused history, taking appropriate examination and appropriate and focused examination, and feedback and meeting concern of the patient. These are the three important components of encounter with the patients. So these are very important. So most of the candidates actually don't know what is the focused history, what should be the focused history. So it actually depends on case, according to the case. So to take the focused history, a candidate should actually practice a lot in different case scenarios. Like in this case scenarios, Mr. Anderson, 60 years old, presented with shortness of breath. I can give you an example. So you can ask the patient, you can enter into the room and ask the patient, like that. Hello, I'm Dr. Hussein. I'm one of the candidates here. I have been asked to talk to you and examine you. Is it okay for you? Take the permission of the patient like that. Then you can ask, I have got a letter from your GP that state that you have short of breath. Would you please tell me more about it? So it is better to start with open-ended question that would you please tell more about your short of breath. Then the patient or surrogate will tell you his about his symptoms. Then you can ask about the symptoms elaborately, some like how long have you had this shortness of breath, and how did it start, suddenly or gradually, and is there anything that make it worse, and is there make you feel better like using inhalers. And also some associated important question, do you feel short of breath while lying down, like orthopnea? Do you feel short of breath at night, or do you have to wake up at night in search of air, about paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, which is related to congestive cardiac failure? So these are the important questions you should ask, and these are the focused questions. You can also ask important things like how far you can go without being short of breath. Assess the physical condition of this patient is very important. And if a patient show the distress that I have shortness of breath, and so you can give show some empathy during that time of taking history, so you will get marks in our patient's welfare. Like I can see that you're passing a very hard time very shortly, and you can ask this that and also regarding focus history related to respiratory cause, you can ask about do you have any lung condition, like any asthma or anything else. Do you have any heart condition, any heart disease? You can ask this. And the family history of, do you have any family history of heart disease? It is very important. It is related. But you should not, it is not decision two that you have 14 minutes time to discuss all the, take all the systemic inquiry. It is not decision two. So you have to be concise. You have to be focused. You can ask related personal history or socioeconomic history. You can ask about smoking history, which is very much related to shortness of breath. Alcohol history, which may cause cardiomyopathy and associated shortness of breath. You can take occupational history and related to the exposure to the asbestosis. So it is very important. You have to know that what type of questions, what focused question you should ask. And so there are certain questions you should ask routinely in a station five. Like number one, you should ask about any medication history, very much important. What medication you are taking, you should ask it routinely. Another thing is, do you have any other surgery before? Because in station cases, there may be some faint scar, patient may hide the scar. So if you ask about the surgical history routinely, you may not, there's a less chance that you may miss the any scar marks. So you may not miss a sign also. And you should also ask about the quality of life, very important. Most of the candidates actually don't ask about the quality of life. How does the symptoms, how does this shortness of breath affects your life? And with whom you are living, do you need any help? And if the patient said that I'm a smoker, and you can quantify the smoking and also provide help of smoking cessation clinic. These are the focused and what you should not ask, like in this case, shortness of breath. If it is not related to this, you can should not ask about, initially you should not ask about the bowel habit, bladder habit, if it is not related to your presenting complaint. Because if you take the unnecessary history, there is a chance that you might lose some important history, and also you may fail to do appropriate examination. So it is very important to be focused on station five during taking history. And then come to the point of appropriate examination. It is very important because most of the examiner will not remember what you asked during your history taking session, but they will certainly remember how you perform your examination, how skillful and how smooth and during your examination. So it is very important to do examination very smoothly, fluently, and and you can acquire this by practicing a lot. And so what is the focused examination? So I'm giving example, like this case, the patient present with shortness of breath. So during your examination, during an history taking session, your diagnosis may be respiratory cough. So you should go for the respiratory system examination first. Like if you think that diagnosis is COPD, you go for respiratory system examination first. And if you think that diagnosis is chronic congestive cardiac failure, you should go for the cardiac examination first. So it depends on your etiology, and depends how you think. Okay, so it is very important. And another thing is, will you do whole respiratory system examination? No, you should not. You will do the important respiratory examination. Like you should auscultate the chest, you can percuss and see the tracheal position. These are the important things. You should not go for chest expansivity in station 5 because it will cost you time. Rather, it won't help you regarding your diagnosis. So, and you should not go for vocal frameters in this part. So it is very important to know that it is not necessary to do systematically. So you can do the important part of the respiratory system examination. And other than that, you can look for the respiratory rate. You can ask for the vital signs, vitals observation chart. And then if you think that cardiac cause is your differentials, you can also ask for cardiovascular system examination, like auscultation of the chest. And you can see the edema because some respiratory condition COPD may be associated with core pulmonary. So you have to know what should you do during the what is the your focused examination according to the your case scenarios. Now, and another thing, routinely ask for the observation chart during examination. And important that there are certain important things you should not do during examination, like never ever examine over the clots. Never ever. Okay, is very important because many candidates fail only for this reason. You will lose marks in your physical examination, you will lose marks in your signs. And never ever invent any sign. If you are not sure about any sign, if you think that it may be plus minus, so you should not tell this sign. If you think that it is obvious that there is a wheeze, there is a crackles, fine crackles, or then you can go for this. And so it is very important not to invent sign. And another thing is always give thanks to the patient, and also tell the patient that if you feel any discomfort during my examination, please let me know, and it will provide you the marks in welfare. Now, third part is patient's feedback and meeting the concern is very important, because concern is a skill in which many candidates fail. So, during encounter with the patient, you will have 8 minutes time. After 6 minutes, you will be given some warning that you have 2 minutes left. And when the examiner will tell that you have 2 minutes left, then you should start for meeting concern and giving feedback. And how will you give feedback? You can give feedback in two parts. Like in initial part, you will explain the diagnosis to the patient. Better to tell the diagnosis, and you can tell that I have some other possible. There are some possibilities also. And after that, you will give the patients about your management plan. Management plan means regarding your investigation plan, regarding your treatment plan. So what might be the feedback, appropriate feedback? Like suppose a patient with COPD, you can give feedback like that after talking to you and examining you, I think you are suffering from a condition. We call it chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. It is a condition of lung, because it is due to the your lung tissue has been damaged. The tissues are being damaged most probably due to your heavy excessive smoking. And so what we are going to do right now, I'm going to run some test in the form of some blood test, some image of your chest, imaging of chest, and some special type of lung, your lung function, some special type of lung function test. So after doing all this test, we'll have a team of expert or multidisciplinary team we'll have a meeting regarding your further management. Our team of experts includes our chest doctor, lung doctor, our chest physiotherapist, our specialist nurse. We are all here to help you. Do you have any other concern? So there may be another concern whether I should get admitted in the hospital. It is a very important question, and some candidates fail to answer these questions appropriately. So you need to know that in which situation you will admit the patient. Suppose a patient presented with acute exacerbation of COPD, and you think that the patient is on respiratory failure, type 2 respiratory failure, you should admit this patient. You have to keep the oxygen nebulization, bronchodilators, and also steroids may be given. You can give BiPAP. So if a patient presented with shortness of breath and a patient presented with like pleural effusion or in fever, cough, pleural effusion, and the patient does not have any shortness of breath, so in this case you should not admit this patient. You can arrange this patient in urgent outpatient basis. So it depends on the underlying case, and you have to decide when you should admit this patient. And another question may be during your encounter with the patient may ask, is it curable? So some diseases are not curable, like connective tissue disease, systemic sclerosis. In that case, the response may be, I may have to say that the condition you are suffering from is not curable. However, we can manage your symptoms with our team of experts or multidisciplinary team, and we have some medications and some form of treatment that will help you to relieve your symptoms. And after all these things, you should ask at the end of the encounter with the patient, do you have any other concern? Because you have to take the marks of concern. It is very important. So this is all about encounter with the giving feedback, and during giving an explanation, the patient, please try to avoid jargon. Do not use simple word to explain the diagnosis. And you should also tell there are other possibilities also that will help you to get marks when you miss the diagnosis. It's very important. So after at the end of the session, you should give thanks to the patient, and it is very important, and you will get marks in welfare for this. And before entering the room, please don't forget to wash your hands. So the last part about which is the encounter with the examiner, we'll discuss this part in another video. Hopefully this video will be helpful for you. If you have any comments regarding this video, any opinion, please feel free to share your opinions or any comments, and thank you for watching.